Musura mekukuriswa na stepfather uye mai baba vachinge vashaika at a very tender age. Mai Maketeni shared a story of looking for her biological father and nyaya yacho yakatozokora muto. Musura meunge maititi vavatukira vabereki vavo uye kugova vachiti vanoroya. Welcome back to your channel. Please don't forget to like and subscribe. So a previous video yedu tataura her journey until dede wavo a stepfather vashaika. So tichango tangira a pataka gumisira. Vasato wana video, please do go back to the first video ya kanza. Mai Maketeni shares her life story. No one argued about Gogo going with me. But then Gogo gave another request. Ndokumbira kumbotora vakomana sezvo vachiri vadiki. Uyezve tendai anorwara anoda rudo rwaamai. There was a little debate and some back and forth until everyone agreed that Gogo takes the three of us. I had a great relief in my heart that we were all going to stay with Granny, at least have a better life. I and my siblings were very happy. That day even Tendai, who had always been sad, smiled too. We travelled safely to Highfield, looking forward to the next phase of my life. A few days later, Gogo took us to a nearby school called Mofu Primary and enrolled me and Shepherd there. I remember telling the headmaster, Mr. Guja, "Ava vazukuru vangu vakafirwa, inherera dzangu nditarisire iwo, headmaster." Those days, death being an orphan was something people respected so much, and it was not very common. The headmaster made sure we were treated well, and most people were feeling sorry for us. At school, I was my brother's shield. Everyone knew it. I would attack everyone who got in his way. I defended him in anything, with everything in me. I felt sorry for him, knowing that we had been through. Everyone who attended school at Mofu Primary during my time knew. This was when we started feeling at home, and I could see my brother smile often. My younger brother did not recover, and his growth was greatly affected by his illness. Gogo was now a regular at the local clinic, Pawutsanana in Kenan, and she always took my brother every day for treatment. She struggled so much, and no help was coming from my stepfather's side. My grandfather used to work an average job that managed to sustain everyone. I thank God for him. Time went by, and we thought the storm was over. But guess what? Another bombshell dropped. Since my stepfather was a full-time soldier, he was entitled to a package from the military army. Previously, my stepfather's brother had told Gogo that he will fix everything, and if the package is out, he will give Gogo the money to assist with the upbringing of the kids. Fast forward, my stepfather's brother managed to submit all paperwork and lied to the army that is the one staying with us. But there was a hiccup along the way. I'm sure the army really wanted to be sure that he was the one taking care of the kids before releasing the funds. So I think they requested to see the kids, not sure about this though. So this bamkuru came to Highfield and said to Gogo, "I have decided to take the kids so that I help you. Look, Tenda is always ill. Let me assist you, Mama." Gogo was convinced and she gave him Shepherd and Tendai. And I was very young, but I could see that this man is not honest. He was pretending. I had seen how Sylvia treated us. So I just felt that these are people that are what makes him exceptional. They are one people. As a child, I couldn't change anything, but my heart bled. This bamkuru came as a sheep in wolf clothing. Gogo started packing clothes for my brothers. Then I quickly thought of a plan that I thought would save my brothers from going. I told Shepherd to run away and hide somewhere. We ran together and hid him in a car scraper at Gazaland. I told him I'll bring him food. He must stay there till bamkuru is gone. I had hoped that if it's late, he will give up and go. Childish mind. Poor me. When I got back, Gogo asked me about Shepherd's whereabouts, and with a straight face I said, "I don't know." Late afternoon I took some bread and juice and ran to him and told him to stay here till night. I'm sure he will be gone by then. Little did we know that this bamkuru wanted these boys at all costs. Hours later, as it was now dark, I went back home. This bamguru was still there, and people were now getting worried about my brother's whereabouts. My uncle suggested to go to the police. Out of fear of police, I then quickly said, I know of Shepi's friends whose house we didn't check. Let me run there and check. I went to Shepi and told him our plan will not work. I guess you just have to go, because if police is involved, you'll be in soup. He wept and wept until he gave in. We both cried all the time till we got home. The boys and bamguru left. This bamguru back then stayed in Bulawayo and still stays there till today if he's still alive. Time went by, and one day Gogo decided to visit my brothers. She took me along. When we arrived in Bulawayo, we got the shock of our life. The kids were since taken to the Shawane Rural to Sylvia and her mom. A close relative felt very sorry for us and confessed everything to us. The kids never attended school here. This bamguru kept the boys to lure the pension money. As soon as the man was released, he sent them to the village. The few weeks that the kids stayed here, they were not going to school and also stayed in the servants' quarters. My heart was shattered. My heart bled. I started crying, couldn't control myself. Knowing how Sylvia was, shakandikuvadza moyo wangu. This close source then gave us direction to the village where the boys were, and we left for Harare with a plan of going to Zishavane soonest. We got back to Harare, and my life changed completely. It was never the same again. Knowing that my brothers are suffering in the hands of Sylvia, zvakandikuvadza moyo wangu. I started working very hard, plaiting people, helping Gogo raise money to go and see my brothers. Remember, I was still in school. When we got money for one person, I asked Gogo if I could go first, using the directions we were given. I also told her, since we don't know the place, I have to check before you struggle with me, trying to find the place and also waste money for two people. I was very close to Gogo. She agreed. I was young, but very intelligent and clever. I matured quickly because of the things I had gone through. I prepared my lunch and packed fruits and water, and I started off my journey from Baremsika to Zishavane. The place was very far, and we passed through Boterekwa and went deep inside gorges, very remote areas, kunonze kuzasi kwechakasara. I was praying all the way to Zishavane. It was indeed a long journey to get to Zishavane. Prior to departure, I had told the driver and conductor where I wanted to drop. When we got to Zishavane, I started constant reminders so that I won't pass my stop. After a couple of stops, there came mine and I dropped off. I was looking very fine, wearing my best clothes. Everyone could tell that I'm new in that area, but I wore my confidence, took out my directions, and started following them as I walked. The directions were not so clear, but I didn't want to ask anyone before trying. And also the fact that I was new, people might take advantage. I walked the first bit, then asked on the second bit as it was now becoming fair and clear. I asked one of the old men and he gave me his grandson, a little boy, to escort me to the house. When we were now approaching Sylvia's homestead, the boy pointed it from a distance and he returned. From afar, I could tell that there was no one at home, but I was afraid to ask the boy. I was afraid to bear bad news. As I was approaching, I saw very old and dilapidated rooms, some without doors and windows, like a haunted house. I kept drawing closer. Now it was so clear that no one was home. There was a tree almost at the center of the yard. I walked towards it to sit under for shade. There was a sack under that tree, and I decided to go and sit on it. When I got to the tree, I saw movement under the sack. It was something very flat, and I thought it was a snake. I jumped in panic and shouted, "My way!" in my vernacular. That very moment, I heard a very small voice calling, "Shepi! Shepi! Todamvura!" I quickly opened the sack, and I saw it was my brother Tendai, who was covered by a sack. No one was home. Everyone had gone to the farm and left him home with no food or water. This was like his routine every day. My heart broke. I burst into tears. My brother Tendai was dying. I had seen kids from Somalia who were very thin but never thought they actually existed. That was my brother stated this time. I was shattered. I cried so hard, shouting, "Go, go," but she was nowhere near. I had some fruits and leftover food. I tried to sit him down, but he couldn't. I held him like a baby in my arms and made him drink water. He was very thirsty and hungry. I tried to feed him, but he wasn't in a good state to eat properly. No one came home until 6 p.m. I saw a number of people walking towards the house in sort of a single file. When Shepard saw me, he dropped the hoe he was holding and ran towards me, smiling. When I hugged him, he wept so much that I couldn't hold my tears too. He whispered, "Memo, ndoda kuenda newe, usati see." Sylvia, siblings, and a mom were also approaching. They were shocked to see me. The mom exclaimed, "Ah, memory, wawuya nani? Wafika sei kuno, hauna kurasika ere. Ah, budi havana kutawura wanu kuturukuya. Ah, waita basa, wawuya. Wakadi yako." I just said, "Tete, matire gerera." She failed to say anything in response, but I could see guilt written all over her. Sylvia could not look at me. She was too shy to look into my eyes. I didn't have extra money for the boy's birthday, but in my mind I said, "I will not leave my brothers here for an extra day." We had a few moments with Shepi and Tendai alone. They told me the life they had lived over the years in the village. I told them, "I'm not leaving you behind. I would rather stay here with you than leave you behind. We will go to Harare together. I don't have enough money, but I'm thinking of a plan." They cooked dinner and I refused to eat. I survived with fruits that night. I couldn't wait for night to pass so that tomorrow I execute my plan. Since that time, rural buses were scarce. I had prior asked the driver the time they normally pass by the bus station. He told me 3 a.m. There was only one bus, and if you miss it, you are doomed. The boys didn't have any nice clothes to wear. I picked one better outfit for each and left the rest behind, as they were tattered and torn. I told myself that, money or no money, I'm leaving this place with my brothers. Without fail, I had faith that it would work. Gogo wasn't aware of this decision, since mobile phones were not there, but I knew she wasn't going to complain. My brothers didn't sleep shame with the fear that they might see me gone. In the wee hours of the morning, as we were preparing to leave, Sylvia's mom woke up and came, then said, "Are you sure you'll be able to travel with Tendai in this state?" I was too emotional to respond. I only managed to nod my head. She seemed unbothered that I was taking the boys. She was actually relieved because the way she had neglected Tendai was to let him die out of hunger. I carried Tendai on my back without a baking towel and covered his head with my jacket. As he was very thin, I didn't want people to be staring at him. Before we left for the bus, I said to Sylvia's mom, "It is well." We go to the bus station. After a while, as I saw the bus coming, I held on to my faith. When the bus stopped, people got in before paying, and bus conductor would then come to ask for money when people are seated whilst the bus is moving. I set my brothers down and walked to the bus door to tell the conductor my situation. Before I said anything, I started crying. The conductor said, "Kochi, ndi uze, usacheme." Ah, it got even worse. That drew the driver's attention. He said, "Okay, chimbono garapasi, dozota urane wenda kunyora ma tickets." I went back to my seat. After a few minutes, the conductor came. He asked, "What is it?" In tears, I replied, "We are three, but I have money for my brothers only. I don't have a fare for myself. I need your help. I'm selling some clothes and shoes. Those were mine. If you want, we can exchange those clothes with my ticket, or I can sit and hold them on my lap. If this is not possible, we can use one seat. My brother Shepherd sits and holds little Tendai on his lap. As for me, I don't mind standing all the way to Harare." I was 14 years of age at this time. After explaining to the conductor, he said, "Chini Harare kutema, reganduze driver nyaya yako." He continued with issuing tickets to other people. Then he went back to the driver. A moment later, he came and said, "It's okay. Pay what you have. It will cover for all of you." The driver has understood. As he was still talking, I burst into tears and cried even more. He got confused and said, "Ah, kwa kuchema foot. Hanti takubatzera. Chi foot." I replied, "Ah, Sorry, conductor. I'm crying because my brother is sick. I just cried tears of joy that at least we can now go to Harare together for him to receive treatment. The conductor went on to ask, Ko mama venyu aripi? This made me cry even more. I'm sure he figured that our mother was late. I kept crying uncontrollably, and my brother started weeping too. The conductor really felt bad for asking. Everyone in the bus was now looking at us. People didn't understand what was going on. Then conductor suggested we go and occupy the back seat so that Tendai can sleep since he was very sick. The journey was not an easy one. A lot of things happened on our way to Harare. Fast forward, we arrived at Mbaremsika. Then I quickly thought of selling my clothes so that we get a taxi home, as it was now late. Plus, Tendai was very unwell. I sent my brothers inside the terminals and told them not to move an inch. I ran to one lady who was selling vegetables. I told her, I'm selling clothes. This woman with a bit of shock, she said, What's one epi? Hauna kubayere mwanaiwe? Unogara kupi? I couldn't respond. I just started crying and walked away. In my mind, I just said, does this woman know what I'm going through? I then approached a gentleman who was selling cigarettes. He directed me to some ladies who sell secondhand clothes. Ish, this was taking too long for me. I got there and those ladies didn't hesitate. One of them offered her price and I agreed immediately. All I wanted was money for a taxi. I ran back to my brothers. When I got there, Tendai was sobbing, while Shepherd was trying to calm him. But he also had tears in his eyes. I'm sure at this point they thought I had just abandoned them, as I took a bit longer to return. We got a taxi to Highfield. As we were now approaching home, I cried tears of joy, thanking God for his mercy. It was now around 7 p.m. We got to the house. The boys showed a bit of relief, though Tendai was very ill. The moment I opened the door, Gogo was eating, seated on the couch, holding a plate. I said, Oh, gee, in Malawian vernacular, meaning knock knock. Gogo responded, Eh, tilandile alendo. Welcome visitors. But she had not seen I had the boys. The moment she saw the boys, she dropped the plate and stood up quickly. Zukulu wanga, kodi kulibwino, my grandchildren, is everything okay? With tears in my eyes, I swerved to my left a bit to show Gogo Tendai's face. As she was still in shock, she quickly grabbed him off my back. With tears in her eyes, she said, Abigero, iwe wona vana vako vatambura kani. She hugged the boys tight at once with tears and said, Ndakulandilani azukulu anga. Zikomo mulungu. Welcome, my grandchildren. Thank you, Lord. This broke my heart. Gogo was heartbroken too. By nature, she was an emotional being. She cried, talking, calling my mom's name. A moment later, I explained to Gogo everything that had happened. Her response was, Wakaita shakanaka. Wauya nevana. Mangwana toita. Zeku clinic. She fixed a place for us to sleep, Tairara Pazimu lounge. But we were very content. Gogo said a word of prayer before we went to sleep. The next day, we went to the local clinic and Tendai was said to have developed kwashioka during his illness. Gogo explained the situation behind everything and the nurses understood. He was put on a food program at the clinic whereby we will take him for feeding every day at the clinic. Gogo dropped everything in her life at this time, to attend to a grandson. She was literally at home all day, every day, with Tendai, making sure he is well fed and takes his medication religiously. Gogo, you will forever be my number one hero. Continue to rest in power. Gogo went back to Mofu Primary School to enroll Shepherd back to finish off his primary education. The headmaster suggested that he repeats previous grade since he had missed so much already. I was now in high school at Highfield 1 in Machipisa. Those who attended high school from 95, you know me. I participated in a lot of activities and never for once did I show my problems at school. I only shared with a friend of mine called Sharon Dindi, who you can confess to this. I was a very jovial student who raised the school flag in sports. I was very good in athletics, netball, scripture union, shakawanda, shakawanda. Tendai's health constantly kept deteriorating, but Gogo did not lose hope on him. She did the best she could for him to be fine, but her finances were not so good. Sometime back, there was a day when my father came to Highfield trying to see me and he was calling me, waving his hands. I ran to Coco and told her, there is a man calling me. She then said, Memo, uyo mrume uyano babana, usambufoka kaenda kwari. I only said, okay, but with a lot of unanswered questions. Fast forward, time went by, and out of desperation to help Coco financially, I thought of something, and I asked her to give me a listening ear. I said, Coco, who is my father, and where is he? Coco was shocked. She replied, I then said to her, Mom told me about it when we were still in Inkomo, and she told me you explained to me when I grow up. She then said, where is all this coming from? Why are you asking me this day? I said to her, since I had my father somewhere, I was hoping you could look for him so that he helps you take care of us, since I was also looked after by their father too. This really broke Coco's heart, and she dropped a tear, but she just acted strong and said, Dichakudza zvese kana wapedza chikoro. After this response, I realized, so it's true that our late dad is not my father. It hit me so hard, but I didn't want to push Coco to say things before she was actually ready. Fast forward, Tendai's health kept going up and down. Overall, I can only say Coco did her best to help Tendai. Unfortunately, after a while, time came, Tendai passed at an age of 8. Rest in peace, my brother. We'll always love and remember you. His death broke my heart and my soul was completely troubled. Coco reached out to Bamkuru in Bulawayo, informing him about Tendai's death. Bamkuru did not attend my brother's funeral. He sent a relative to stand in for their family. I know he couldn't face Coco after everything that happened. Bamkuru, if you are still alive, God will judge you. You failed your brother's kids because of money. You neglected them because you were too ashamed to call them your children. After Tendai's funeral, I realized that his death affected us and our lives changed completely. Shepherd and I became very low and we were at a very low moment. We told each other that we are now alone. Life is not easy, guy. Being an orphan is the worst thing that has ever happened to me. We tried to go back to our normal lives, but it was never the same again. We both became very emotional beings. Even at school, any silly thing made us cry. I promised my brother that I will always be there for him, no matter what. I told him, where I go, you will go. If it means we sleep under the bridge, we will do it together. I told him to wipe away his tears, and we went back home. This day, I vowed that I will never leave Shepherd, even if I'm to get married. Time went by. Then Shepherd revealed very heartbreaking news that I could not believe, which also broke my heart. Not any of my relatives know this. Only when I thought we were getting over Tendai's death, Shepherd asked if we could go somewhere to talk, just the two of us. We walked to CJ Hall and sat there. He started narrating a story. He was sexually abused when he was in Rishavan. Sylvia was one of the women who abused him. He lost confidence in himself. His self-esteem was very low. My brother struggled. He cried so hard. And I did too. We didn't know what to do, and we couldn't share because of fear. Life as an orphan is not easy, guys. I can't control my tears. Let me stop here. Orphans have a special place in my heart. I love you all. This story is very emotional, guys. I actually shed a tear when I was reading this, and my voice kept on breaking. Guys, this is not only a story of hope, we are my market and worker, but it is going to inspire a lot of children, and it is also going to let most of the orphans who grew up vasina vabereki to know that it is possible. Yes, you can lose a parent today, but it is possible to just grow out of it and become a victor. Guys, ukaona life ya my marketing, yangu wa life mwe yatino to draw, ya life yatino werenga mabuku, tichibata mamagazine, tichiwona pa Netflix, but ukatarisa kwa varu kubwa, kwa kawoma, and we just want to thank God for the grandmother, kugwa vana kusia vana mwano wawo, waka chengeta. And hey, mama, wacho, we also want to thank Chero posthumously. The fact that she married a guy, but wakarika kusia mwana kuna koko, and she carried the children. the child kuenda kunyu marriage. Pamoja na babu wacho, he was a very good stepfather. Wakachengeta mwana asiri wabu kumukuza zokutuwa ticharu pakashaika mai vakasara vachida kuchengeta memo semu ana wabu. Guys, inyaya ii, ino dadisa, yes, it is very painful, but it is full of hope. It is full of hope. Yanyansa kundiru waza ndia watete mai wa Sylvia. Pamoja na Sylvia wacho kuti ana kuwa satisfied nesho hakaitira wana vachiri kugara wengomo. Atora vadika hawa vaindu wanavo kunogarwa navo Shabani guys kumusha ikoko vana vachaindi kuchikoro posi wa mwana akagarari wani payadi vachiziva kuti anorwara akarara akafugizwa chisaga kukonwa kana kuwaridzira mwana waraiti zvakanaka kokumbereka kuenda naye if he needs help and you are not there kokusenga mwana kuenda naye kumunda kana muchisakura muchifamba naye muchimushifta muchidaro zvinoradza kuti kerim ivo bamukuru vacho ivava vanotora mwana voenda naye votora vana voenda navo kuti vawane pension fund then after that vodamba vana ve mwai vabuti vako. The brother had a very beautiful heart. You can see the way he raised Memo. But vano itaonge wakaswa kukutuwa wari wani. Wari wawo gavane moe wakanaka udaru. Because watete mai wa Sylvia. Wangu wane moe wakaipa. Bamkuru wavo. Wangu wane moe ose wakaipa. Ungarega mwana wabudi wako achitambura. Choko adi. Otora pension fund that was meant for the children. Mojika moto kota mope za nyaya. Ah, guys, nyaya ndirwaza singaiti. Okay, guys, so this is a very emotional story. We will keep you updated as the story develops. This is a very, very sad story. But anyway, for now, do leave your comments on what you think about nyaya yedu yekwa Mai Maketeni. Ah, nyigaka takura kurema, guys. You actually see people out there, vachismaila, vachimayane ma emero, ma jiero, ma bens, ma kuru, and you feel like, wanda kuwonere, wanda, hey, guys, if it means kuti she will post it, that emero ka, kana kuti mansion yava, kana kui post every day, let her be, because she's been through so much, so much. Vese wana ita so head, gava tombo mira panya hii, because guys, we are going to stand na Mai Maketeni zvokutodaro. If you don't know someone's struggle, it is very easy to judge them based on a minute or funga. But now that we've walked this journey with her, no guys, Memory deserves all the happiness that she can get.